Bali. So this was one thing I did for Bangladesh Excel Summit, and I felt, okay, this is also going to be useful for the power financial modeling community, because a lot of what I touched on relates to how you can analyze things that relates to financial transactions and also budgeting and things relating to financial planning. So that's what the examples around these are, a bit tailored around things around planning, budgeting, business research. So let's go straight into the practice file that I have. Think I already have it opened. Yes, this is, I need to bring it from the other screen to here. Okay, so maybe I will share it later, or let me try to share the file now then, in case anybody wants to practice along. I'm gonna save the file, go to my Azure storage, make sure I close the file so that there won't be any corruption or errors. So let me just give us the file right now then. Those who want to practice along, good. And more importantly, I won't forget, because this the rate I forget things. It will just be like some seconds. Doesn't take long. Storage. Okay, this is the storage. Then, okay, so this is where I'm supposed to load the file. Upload file. Select the file. This is it. Upload. Okay. Refresh. Let's refresh. Refresh. Okay. Grab the file. Last modified. Okay, this is it. Copy URL. Go to Teams. Go to chat. So here is today's practice. Okay. Okay. So I'm going to go back to Excel. Just again. File, bring it back to this screen. So if you want to practice along or practice afterwards, or you need to drop off the session before the end, at least you have the practice file link. So we start. Number one is index, and maybe this might, I forgot to replace the Bangladeshi naira symbol there, I mean currency symbol days. So let me say Nigerian naira. So index is a formula that for me I find really, really versatile. It's one of those formulas that you start using and you start coming up with more things to use it for. So let me start with a very simple example of what index really is, and then we can go about adding some more meat to it. So index, this is how I like to describe index. Index is a formula that allows you to specify a table, right? And then you can specify the row number, the column number to get you what is on that row and column. So imagine that I have a table. That has this number of rows. So this is row one, row two, row three, row four, And then it has also this number of columns, column 1, column 2, column 3, column 4, column 5. If I need something that is maybe here, right? What will I do? It's going to be index that table. Then if you look at it, the row number is number 3, row 3. Then column is column 4. So if I do that, it will get for me what is in that position. So that is index. Now let's quickly, if you have used index and match before, that's the way we've been using it. Let me come up with a table I can use for illustration. Once you understand it, you will even be able to use it beyond the examples that I've prepared for us for today. So I have people's names. Let's ignore the people's names. Let me just put some random figures. Random. Okay. So if you remember what I said, if I want something that is here, what did I say? It's going to be index the entire table. Let me zoom so that I don't know what device you are using. So if you have any question, please feel free to ask as the session is ongoing. You know, let me also put my chat in view so that I will notice any question. Okay, great. No questions yet. So I select the table, right? And then let's count it together. This is row 1. This is 1. This is 2. This is 3. This is 4. It's not easy to write with the mouse. This is 5. So that's obviously row 5. And then let's count the column. Column 1, column 2, column 3, column 4. So it's going to be 5,4, row 5. So row 5, comma, column 4. And guess what we pop up? 1, 2, 4, 6. So clear? Now that is the first way I try to explain index. Now there are two other ones, but there's one more that I need to show us, okay? So when it's not a table, if I have a list, now my list can be like this. You know, this can be my list, where I have different items. Item 1, item A, item B, item C, item D, item E, item F, item G. Also, my list can be this way. So that's the nice thing about this other one I want to show us. Right? Regardless of whether it's, you know, row by row or column by column, as long as your table is one of a single row or a single column. So this is a single column. And this is a single row. You can always say index. So let me call it list. Let's call it a list so that I at least let it look as if it's different from a table. This is simply a table, a single column to be a single column, a single row table. Now you don't need to do row and column. All you need to do is position. Just provide the position. That's all. Okay. So if I need this, if I need this guy, all I need to say is list position 3. Right. So let's go test that out. I'm going to grab this, paste it. Then I'm also going to paste another version of it, but transposed. So let's say I need this, right? So based on what I've explained, index, the list, and then position. So let's count together. Position 1, position 2, position 3, position 4, and position 5. I think I have to be picking things closer to the top. So position 5. That will save me the stress of writing with my mouse.
And
you're correct, right? Okay, now that we know the position number, let's say I also need it from here. Okay, I'm also just going to do index the list, comma, position 5. Okay, so with this approach, I do not need to worry about row and column. If you remember, when we are worried about row and column, you will have to be like row first, column next. In this case, forget about that. Just provide the position. And this is the one I use a lot in achieving things that most people don't think of using index for. So let's go now to my practice. In fact, let's start with some interesting ones, okay? So I have, how many of us are on this call? So let's use ourselves as illustration. At least that's the benefit of having a live training. You know, we can always tailor it to what is. So let's say we all are participants, right? Participants. There is obviously me, Michael. I can see Monsieur Anthony. I can see Ladi. So let's start with these three of us. Okay. So let's say there is money that is, we are sharing money. You know, maybe we are doing some election. I don't know whatever it is that is making us to share money, but somehow we are sharing money. So I like to collect like a 900,000. Monsieur Anthony, he doesn't mind 800,000. Galadi wants to collect the biggest amount. So we all know that whenever you have table and figures, we always like to put a chart to sometimes illustrate what is happening, right? And so when we come and we put a chart, this looks great. But then we typically also have situations where the list keeps growing. So as more people join, so I can see Martin in the call. So he joins, he also wants to collect a share of the money. He heard about it that we are sharing money and he's like, where's mine? I'm also here. The issue is that the chart is not capturing him. Okay, so this is one common thing people like to do when they know that their list can expand and contract. Okay, it can contract. Contract means maybe Mr. Ladi and Mr. Martin resign. They say, we are not doing again. Take your money. Okay, I can still see the space for Ladi here, right? Because the thing is not contracting, it's still thinking that there's somebody there. Okay, so what are the ways we like to use? Many people use all kinds of ways, but remember what I'm trying to teach us. I want to show us at the amazing things you can do with index. We can use index. How do we use index? Okay, I'm going to say that I want all these people, okay, which we know is I want all these people, right? In fact, I want all these people. But let's start with the names first so that you get the whole idea. I want all of us, okay? So let me do it somewhere that it will not interfere with the space I have. So I'm going to do it here. I want all of us. We are three for now. So we are three for now. But I want it such that we can be four, we can be two, we can be one, we can be, you know, whatsoever number, right? So what do I do? I need to adjust this last part. This last part should be flexible. This last part should always give me the last person's position. What am I going to do? I will use index. I'm going to say index all. I deliberately will select more than what I currently have. So if I know that I will never have more than 10 people, I can select positions for 10. So that is the list. So remember the example I said, we have a list. All I need to provide is the position that I want. So how will I get the position that I want? The position I want is the last person, obviously, right? The last person is equal to how many people I have in that list. If I have two people, Then the second person is the last person. If I have three people as I have right now, then the third person is the last person. So what do I do? How do we count our number of items in a selection? We use count all or counter. Okay, so I will say count every item in this selection, right? Right? Just take a look at it again. It's what we know, but using it in maybe something we don't usually think of. The index we know. This counter is going to count for me if I do F9. You see, it tells me there are three people. So that's correct. There are actually three there. And remember what I said, three means it's going to get me Lati, right? So three means it's going to get me, let's do F9, Lati. So you'll be like, okay, now I get that part. How is this going to help me out, okay? So the magic about index is, it's when, okay, let's press enter anyway. Let me add one more person here. So let's add, who has joined us? John has joined us. So let's add John. Voila, are you seeing like that John is automatically popping up in this table? Okay. So back to here. We understand what is happening here because I've explained it. Index this entire list. Count how many records I have there. I have four records. So obviously it's going to get me the number fourth person, which as we have seen, that is John. Four, if I press F9, that is John, right? But what is interesting about index is that when you use it in a kind of a position calculation, when I use it in this way, where I am saying I want records like I reference, and I'm putting index as part of my reference here, right? It is smart and nice enough to just, actually the truth is it gives the position, right? So it gives you that reference, that cell address. So because this cell is now within a formula, it will give it as this that you are seeing. Instead of Lati now, it will, let's drag this up a bit. So this is position C73. It's going to give me position C73. That's what that formula is doing there, okay? So now that I've explained that, how would I have used that to fix this graph problem? Very easy. All I need to do is say, for my chart, so we're going to do, John came late, so the money is almost finished when he joined. So I do equal to, I want to do it somewhere that, let's put the chart away for now, equal to all of this, right? Now, what I want is, I want this to be dynamic. So I'm going to say index this entire list, but now much more than what I have there currently, so that I can always allow for more. Contraction is not a problem, it will always do less, but the more is what is the main reason why I'm selecting a lot more. And then I'm going to say count all items I have in that selection, and then I do okay. Voila. So this that I have done is what I'm going to put within a named range. You remember what we call, well, if you don't know, I will do it. So this now, I'm going to copy this. Going to, so there's something about in named range. Okay. If you know you're going to copy something into named range, it's always good to make it absolute referencing. Absolute means, you know, dollar around every portion of the names. If you don't do it, don't worry, you will know because you will be seeing errors that you will know that your stuff is shifting, and then you would, you know, so it's an error that you learn with experience. But the key thing is, I'm going to copy this now, go to formulas, let me zoom, go to name manager, or anyhow you do your name, No, we are just creating a name. It's not important to do it the way I'm doing. So I'm going to say this is what I want to use for my chat data. So I'm going to call it chat data. And then what do I do? I'm going to paste what I copied. So I'm going to say okay. Okay, so right now it has put that my index formula right inside this as a named range. Now that I've done this, what I'm going to do is I'll go back to my charts. So I'm going to go back to this chart. Okay. I don't even need this. So, but let's just leave it that way. So I'm going to go back to my chart. I'm going to say for this chart that I want to do. So you know we have a chart design hub where you go and you look at the time. I'm used to 23 minutes. So where you go and you say you want to select data, right? So when you click select data, it brings up everything that you have in your chart. So I'll do it two ways. I'll do it this way and I'll do it, delete the chart and do it all over again. So here now, I'm going to say that no, I don't want to select a static address. I want to provide that my dynamic address, that one that I've done that is tied to that index, right? And I do okay. Okay, I now remember there's something annoying about chats. So I'm going to pick here. I'll pick two things, not a problem. Okay, good. Leads. It's the same thing we want to do. But you need to add the name. It took me some time to figure that one out, but it's something, it's annoying, doesn't make any sense. You know, but unfortunately you need to add the sheet name. Okay, so once I do that, it should, I hope it has not converted it to ordinary address. Anyway, let's test it out. So if I come here and I add one more person, I think it has changed my computation. Let me just do it from scratch. I'm going to delete this. This going to, for now, select whatever you have, insert, chart, then I go to select data. I want to modify the range. Let me zoom to pick chart data, the one that I've created. Okay. Okay, I see a problem. It keeps changing it. So let's see what we can do. Let's say edit here. So I want it to pick. Let me try some. Money participant. So I'm going to create money. Money is going to be this one. Money will be this one. Index. Count all I have here. It's always annoying me every time I do it. There's always something happening funny. So I remember what I said, make it absolute. Everything absolute. So I'm going to call this money. Okay. So let's grab it. Grab this. Go to formula, name manager, new money. Paste. Okay. So I'm going to do likewise for the participant names. So participant tips, fees, index, this range of records, comma count all I have in this range of records. And like I explained, absolutes. I'm going to grab it. Go to name manager. I'm going to call it participants. Okay, good. So let's go try another way. So I don't need this, just what I need from it. I select the chart, the data for chart. I go to insert, I go to the chart, I go to select data. So before I was trying to change just this chart data range, right? But you notice that I kept flipping it back to this one. I can come here and manually be specifying what I want in the series. So let's try that one. So for the series, we are plotting the money values, right? So I'm going to say sheet one money. Okay, let's see. Yes, so it retained it. So this is better. I don't know why they keep creating different experiences. So, but I've seen what I want. This will work. So this one will be participants, the names of the participants. So let me just verify if it retained. Perfect, it retained it. So that's all then. Let's see what we have done in action. Let's reduce the screen size a bit. So let's add one more person amongst us. Let's see who somebody else. Moses has also heard about it and is like, hey, where's my owner? And he has connection, so he got a lot more than. Voila, see, his name has popped up. And let's say all these people vexed, they say they don't want again. Okay, so you can see how index can be used for those dynamic stuff, right? And you know what? I want to create a drop down. So, drop down. I go here to data menu, data validation. And then I say I want to make the list is a drop down, so list. And then I say participants, right? That's the name we gave that list of participants. So I say, okay, give me all the participants that we have available. Let's check it out. So for now, there are just Michael and Anthony. Let's bring back the others. Let's add Chidima. Let's go check if, yeah, see. So what did we use? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, what we used is simply equal to whatever it was originally, right? Delete the last portion. Say index should get you who the last person is. Index all possible lengths, you know. So if I think they might get up to 20, I can select, keep selecting further down. And then I say comma, the position. So position of the last person is equal to counter the last. Well, in that list, count how many records I have. So if there are six people in this room, then the last person is obviously the sixth person. Okay, so that's it. Close all the brackets. Now there's going to be a problem. This thing will spill. Anyway, it will complain. So I'm going to just copy it and go and put it where there's going to be space for it. So let's just put it somewhere else, like here. Head space is enough. Voila, it works. Okay, so that's index. Okay, now this index that I've explained, once you understand it this way, a whole lot of possibilities begin to flash at you. Okay, so look at the example I've done here. You by now, if you've been doing our session, you'll be familiar with this my format of financial model template, or like explaining what the company plans to do. So you always know that I talk about scenarios where you are able to create, okay, I'm wanting to model three different scenarios. That's a common, like the de facto, best case, worst case. Now, the thing is this. The real magic is in the fact that when someone selects a scenario, right, if I pick worst case or best case, that's what should be applied. That's what should feed into subsequent calculations like revenue and all. So let me just let me look at how many minutes. Well, I'm not in a rush. I have this year and next year. So I'm going to delete what I have here. Let me just delete face masks. Okay, so I've deleted for face masks. Okay, then so you see face masks is empty. So let me just color it separately so that you be aware of that. So we'll do for face mask, right? And then you'll see how it is that index that we just explained that I'm using. Someone's hand is up. Yeah, Mr. Sadiq, your hand is up. Yes. You've dropped your hand. You've raised your hand again. Yes, you can speak. Oh, you can. Okay, Lad is asking, can we share the video recording afterwards? Yes, definitely. Okay. It's like Mr. Sadiq is not certain of whether he wants to ask us a question or not. So I'm going to continue, right? So let's see what is happening here. You have a business you want to start, okay? Or you have started. You are producing face masks because you are taking advantage of this pandemic, nah? And sanitizers, test tubes, syringes. Today I bought syringes. It's been longer. I never knew I'm going to use the product I'm modeling for people until today when I needed to fix something in my printer. And then I was watching a video, and before I know it, I've been following the video, then up onto one place, they put out a syringe. I'm like, this guy should have mentioned this ahead now. So anyway, we who are also into printing stuff, sometimes we use syringes. But the key thing is, these are your plans. You have said, my production plan is one, where's the volume now? 500,000, 600,000. These are your production volume plan based on capacity and demand. This is the price you want to sell the carton of the face masks at. So these are your plans generally. Then naturally, you want to say, what if things go better than you have envisaged? So we want to have like a best case. What if things go not as well as you thought? But then when that's your original plan, that becomes your level-headed case, your base case. So now let's delete what I've done here. Let's delete everything for face masks, okay? So your level-headed case is going to come, your base case will come from what you have, your business research people, your feasibility studies have said. So we have, based on everything, everybody who is experts that you have engaged have said, you should be able to produce 500,000 quantities in the first year. You know, we fix that in there, we drag it, and that gives us our base case. And then you want to say, what if you are able to do 20% better than that? 20% better than that means the base case times 20%, 1.2, you know, 20% more. Okay, so let's just do it that way. And I drag, so that will get me every year that we do 20% better than what we expected. What if I do 10% or, yeah, I do less. So what if I do 10% less? Okay, so 10% less, 0.9, you know, that's 10% less. You get 90% of your plan, okay? So let's say that is our worst case. Now, we are supposed to go and use these figures to calculate our revenues, right? So for us to be able to make this dynamic and say, whenever you pick a scenario here, that is what it should apply. What do I do? Ladies and gentlemen, again, meet index. Index. With index, I can say, all right, these are the options, list of options. Depending on what scenario the user or my model user has selected. So if my model user, let's even do it manually. If my model user selects scenario one, then it will pick the first option, which is best case. Okay. So scenario one, this is it, 600,000. And if you pick scenario two, 500,000. And if you pick scenario three, how with index I can hook it up to be dynamic, what figure gets applied based on the scenario my user has selected. So what I have done is this stuff here, I have already done it in such a way that it is keeping track of your selection as a number somewhere. See, it's keeping track of your selection here for me. So when you pick best case, that's one, best case, that's two, worst case, that's three. Okay, so because I have done that already, all I need to do is simply connect this one to whatever scenario number, pick whatever scenario number my user has selected. Looking for that scenario number now. Lost inside my whole report. Okay, this is it. Okay, and that's just it. So that is how I use index to create dynamic scenarios. Okay, I'm going to go to the next formula. If any questions on this, so once I do this, all I'm doing is all of my subsequent calculations, they are reflecting that one, they are just linking to the outcome of that my scenario index stuff. So this one into this unit price is also linking to unit price for face mask, and I drag them, right? And you will notice that it's saying for the first year we are making 720 million from face mask. And if you check it out, if I change the scenario to worst case scenario, all those figures too will have instantly changed. So we are no longer making 750,000, we are making 405 million, I mean. So that is clear. I'm going to move on to the next in my plan. Let me look at the time. Okay, good, 20 minutes. But that one was even more important. What's the time I spent on it? Okay, so sum if. This is something that most people use already, but maybe when they have situations like what I want to explain, they just forget about the sum if that they already use. They think they must use something more complex, or they start even thinking of doing VBA and programming. You know, when I show them, they're like, I never knew that I can do this. Sometimes some people even use manual process. So let's think of what the scenario I'm trying to paint is about. Let's start first of all with empty everything. I have my bank statement here, so I try to delete people's names so that you won't see their complete names. But anyway, so I have my bank statement, and I have what has happened over, like, I don't know, maybe 1 month or 2 months. So I want to analyze. I want to see how much I spent on restaurants, how much I spent on grocery, how much I spent on, you get the concept, right? So the formula we normally use is to say sum if the category is grocery, sum the debits in my bank statement. Okay, so it's more like grocery, yeah, add up these, look for grocery again, add up these. Okay, so the formula that does it really quick and fast is sum if. Okay, so what do we do? You say sum if, or let's use the plural one, so that one works all the time. So sum ifs, the sum range is where all the value figures are. So these, my expenses will show up in debit, right? So that's it. So sum all the money that are in the debit column, comma, check that the category. So category is the criteria range. Check that the category, right, is equal to the category I am interested in, restaurants. interested in restaurants, money I spent on restaurants. Okay. And I close the bracket and then that's it. I do enter and I drag down. And then, you know, I should be worried if I'm spending this kind of money on restaurants even more than I spend on personal care. But that the figures, the that's not the main thing anyway. The thing I want to bring out is that that's the formula that helps us to go from those transactional data to creating things like trial balance, creating, you know, your budget analysis for the month, creating things that are like your analysis of what each call center has spent, you know, like going from the raw transactional data to a category-based data report that is more meaningful, that you can put a chart around and show people this is how. Agabos, you say I need to fix the range. I don't know what you mean anyway. I know fix the range, but I don't know why you want us to fix the range here. But it's working fine anyway. So that is the sum if. Now let's go to something a bit different. Grocery may not be correct. It is. Grocery is correct. Oh, I get what you're saying. See, if you look at my formula, you see that I selected the entire column. When you select an entire column, you won't have that problem of things shifting. So I guess what you mean, like, you know, the things will have shifted. They won't shift when you select the entire column. So the moment you do entire column, you don't suffer from that absolute or relative range issue where you select something, you know, maybe I do a selection here, and then when you drag down, so let me just say I do some. And then when you drag down, you find out that it's shifting, everything is shifting. This one has shifted from here to here. It won't happen when you select the entire column, which is what I did in my case. So that's why I need not worry about fixing. Let's now go to this, my example now. I want to see how many transactions I did. In fact, I want to see how much GTB is charging me for VAT, how much they are removing for stamp duty, how much Google is deducting from my money because I use YouTube Premium. I use Google, some of paid Google apps, right? So the situation is one that when the you look at the description, the description comes with more than just what I'm looking for. Look at airtime now. Airtime is coming with some purchase, m-banking, 1-0, things that are not always consistent, right? So I need a formula that we just say as long as in the description, there's cash withdrawal in the description, then that's what I want. Okay, just add it up for me, you know. So that's how you know bank charges. As long as there's bank charges in the description, sum up the value. So the magic is that you need to use wildcards. Wildcards say, so look at an example. Again, let's say we are sharing money. Description months. I say I give Ahmed 1,000 naira. Ladi collected 67,000 naira. Then I say, on 12th of November, Ahmed something something. Maybe that one is 10,000 naira. Then Ladi on 5th October, and that money went into his hand. Let me see, large money this time around. So if I want to see all the total money that we give to Ahmed, right? We all know that if I do some if, myths. And I say some range is obviously this. So this is the sum range. In this case, I need to fix the reference, make it absolute like Moses has advised. Sum range, then criteria range is all of these descriptions. So yeah. The thing is, you'll be like, I'm looking for Ahmed, right? Tell me he cannot. Why? Because Ahmed is not standing alone. All my descriptions have some other, there's no one description that is all entirely Ahmed that is in there. So what do I need to do? I need to use this wildcard. I need to say, as long as it contains Ahmed. So as long as it contains Ahmed means, as long as I don't care if there's anything in front, maybe it is saying Jide Ahmed or I gave Ahmed. I don't care what is in front. Okay. So if I say I don't care what is in front, let's check it out. I don't care what is in front. Now it's getting something for me now. It has gotten this plus this, which is 66,000. Now, what if I have a situation where Ahmed received 20,000 naira? You can see that it has ignored that one, right? The stuff I've done here is saying as long as it ends with Ahmed, that's what I've done. So I don't care if there's something in front, as long as it ends with Ahmed, that's what this one means. That's why this is not going to be gotten. And if I have just Ahmed, it will work. If I have just Ahmed and maybe this time around 30,000, it will pick this one. That's interesting. Scratch some of what I've said. Let me extend my selection, actually. Let's extend selection. But what I've said is still correct. It's just that. Let me delete this one. So you see, it didn't capture Ahmed received. But if I say Ahmed 30,000, it captured that one. So it is not capturing anything that does not end with Ahmed, right? So if I want capture whether it ends with Ahmed, it starts with Ahmed, or Ahmed is in the middle of the entire description, what do I do? I say star. What I'm interested in, star. So that way it's like contains. I'm saying contains. Voila. See, now it works. So if I want to do likewise for Ladi, it's the same process, but let's leave Ahmed and Ladi alone. Let's go back for our own. So cash withdrawal, POS, that's why I did this for them, so that I can be able to say some ifs, right? As usual, the sum range, the debit transactions, then comma, the criteria range, which are the descriptions. Okay, so the description, this one, then comma, what I'm interested in. So right now, I will not pick cash withdrawal because I'm going to have a problem. It will be looking for exactly where there is cash withdrawal in the entire description, which is not the case as regards the descriptions I have. So I need to pick the one that I've applied star, what I'm interested in locating, star after it. So it becomes, as long as it contains cash withdrawal, and boom, that's what I want. So that's what I am doing right now. So sum if in the place debits column, right? The remarks column where all the conditions, criteria, descriptions are, right? But now get for me whatever contains cash withdrawal and going to work. So that is it. Any question before I wrap up with the last thing I have in mind for us? So I'm going to jump. I'll jump Max and me, because I have, what I used to do is I try to put more than what I am certain of covering, so that I don't have a problem where I'm short of time. It's better I have more than what I can fit into the time than to have less than what and waste your time. So Any question before I go on? Let's do Rand. Rand is going to be interesting. I think you will find it interesting because it has a bit of statistics. And for me, I think this way, strategy and analytics and some of all those things people talk about. And when they talk about it, they make it look like you can't do it with Excel, like you have to go and use something complex, maybe like Python or use R. And you see these things before computers, before all these things came. Before Python and R and computers, people are doing this. We're calculating it in hand by our hands. There has been insurance companies long before computers. Some insurance companies are more than 100 years old, right? Then how are they calculating their risks and all those analytics and modeling? In fact, the computers that we are using, the algorithms we are fitting in, if you look at the names, you know, you find out that these are names of scientists that lived like 200 years ago, and we are just writing what they said in computer. So if anybody makes you feel like Excel cannot do some things, just know the person is I don't know, maybe he's just trying to pull you down. Because even biro and paper say can do almost everything. It might just take a bit more time. So let's see the scenario I want to paint. Let me just copy the questions out so that I don't confuse you. Go to a new, then, okay, good. All right, so we have a fashion mega store, but let us give somebody here the store. Let's say for a lady amongst us, they are the ones more fashion oriented. Okay, so I'm going to say this is Chidima store. Maybe say Chi Tu. I think that's the cool name now for stores that are relating to. Chi Tu. Let's go to the problem statement. The problem statement is that she's just starting this business right now. In fact, she's going to start next month, which is November 2021. She has already commissioned people to do market research, feasibility study for her. Okay, so they have told her that the market research has told her that the average shoe size is 40 and that most people are between size 36 and 44. Okay, and the gowns, so she's selling gowns. She's going to start with shoes and gowns. The average gown size is 14. Most people are between size 12 and 16. Okay, so now she needs to buy 100 quantities. She needs to stock up with 100 quantities. So is she going to buy equal quantities of all sizes, or she has to buy more of some sizes than the others? You know, what do you think? Are you going to buy equal quantities of all sizes, or you are going to buy some sizes more than, you know, more quantities of some sizes than the others? What time is going? But some, you can say something. Anybody wants to say something? What is more natural? What happens in reality? You know, in all this, if you have a fashion store, you have somewhere you sell things like shoes and gowns. Anybody, what do you think? Do you buy equal sizes of everything, equal quantities of all sizes, size 50, 10? Size 40, 10, size, everything, you are buying the same quantity or across board. If you are not answering, I will answer myself. So there's what we call normal distribution. Why it's called normal distribution? It's because that's what happens normally. Okay? It's just like our height. We notice that most people, that's why we say there's average height. Most people are 5 feet something. There is that height that's the average, and then most people are in between a particular slim range, and then you will now be seeing a fewer people at some extreme end, someone that will be extremely tall and someone that will be, you know, really short. But most people are kind of like a huge chunk of everybody is in between a particular slim range. So it's called normal distribution. And most things in life, most naturally occurring stuffs follow normal distribution, naturally occurring stuffs are things like our height, our shoe sizes, our gown size or cloth size, so in this case gown size. So there are a whole lot of things in life that follows not normal distribution, even things like intelligence. What do I mean by you do tests, exam for people, you find out that most people are going to score around the particular score band, and then some people score drastically below, and some people score like crazy high above, almost like university too. Now the people who graduate with first class will normally not be more than the people with second class, right? So it's everything follows it. Most people in second class, which is like the middle, fewer people in third class, fewer people in first class. So there's always like a bell shape where most people are in the middle and fewer to both sides of that middle. Okay, so now that the story is done, that is what you will use to do better planning. You know, you have this market research, you will not buy equal quantities of all sizes. You are going to tell Excel to say, generate for me, so let's do that together, equal to, for this Monte Carlo simulation, if you have been hearing about it, that's just it. It's a fancy name, but it's very simple. So I'm going to say, I want to simulate values that are following a normal distribution. So that's why it's called norm inverse. I already have the distribution. I want to go from the distribution back to the values, because naturally what you start with is the values and find the distribution based on the values. Now I have the distribution. I know that these things follow a normal distribution. I want to now go from that distribution back to the values, because when I go to the market, those are the values that we use to buy, you know, the shoes and stock up. So it's called norm inverse. Okay. And then it becomes, what's the probability? So in this probability, we are going to use the formula I'm trying to explain around. So if you notice, let me just show us where I jumped from. You will see that we are trying to explain the formula called RAND. So now that I've brought that back into view, let's go to the norm inverse. RAND to get me random probability numbers. Okay. And then what is the average shoe size? Average shoe size. Average shoe size is 40. 40 is the average shoe size. Okay, 40. So I pick that. In fact, so that you don't read so far too much, let's type it 40. 40 is the average shoe size. Now, what is the standard deviation? What is the meaning of standard deviation? Standard deviation is simply look for a less complex English. I don't want to use the English that is coming to mind, because it's as if I'm using complex words to explain something that is okay. So I'm just going to mention in that way anyway. So there's this theory around normal distribution that shows that 68% will be between one standard deviation away from the mean. So if the mean is 40, right? And so if you look at what we have here, the market research people have told us that 68% are between size 36 and 44. So obviously that means one standard, let's do it again, let's draw it on the screen. It means one I can't write on my screen because I'm in formula mode. Anyway, it means that one standard deviation away from 40, which is the average. This is the average 40. So 36 to the 40 and then to 44. That's where the majority are. So what does that mean? It means that 44 to 36 is one standard deviation. 44 to 40 is one standard deviation. Then 40, you know, downwards to 36 is another standard deviation, right? So that 68% that they say is between those two sizes, just with that information, without doing too much calculation, you can assume or estimate your standard deviation to be 4. You know, there are other ways to calculate it once you have the raw data. It's not difficult to calculate. In fact, the market research people will give it to you difficult. I'm just saying it because I want to dumb things down for us. But these are things that if they didn't give you, if you ask this market research person to break it down into the components, the measures of central tendency is what we call it. So anyway, long story short, the standard deviation is 4, okay? Because 4 people to the size and 4 people above the size, you know, I mean, 4 sizes below, 4 sizes above is where majority of the people are. So when I go back to my formula here, I'm going to say standard deviation is 4. And I'm going to close the bracket. I'm going to now, we know we don't do integer, I mean, we don't do decimal shoe size. So I'm going to just round it. I'm going to say, you know, forget about the decimal part, or let's say round to 0 decimal place so that it comes up as a complete shoe size. And then we need 100, right? So what do? I drag this thing until I get 100. 100 will key up onto 105. So I drag it to 105. So that's how I will know how many quantities I'm going to buy per different shoe. So if I'm going to buy 100 shoes, right, this is the sizes I'm going to send to the wholesaler and say these are what you should sell for me. Now let's do for the gowns. Okay, so for the gowns, it's going to be, again, norm inverse. So probability is random number between 0 and 1. The average gown size is 14, and the deviation is, standard deviation is 2. So 14 is the average gown size, 2 is the standard deviation. And like I said, let us round it so that we don't get any decimal size. And I need how many? 100. So I'm going to drag this to 105. Okay. And this is it. Okay. So with this now, I can show us, let's even do it together. If I take this now and put it on a pivot table, let's forget about pivot table. So if I take this, paste it here, do remove duplicates, data, remove duplicates. Yes, I'm going to get the shoe sizes that are there. I can tell it to sort smallest to largest so that you see. And then I can do our count if A in this range. Count how many of these sizes I need to buy. So it says I need to buy one of that, and I need to buy. So you notice that I need to buy more of these middle sizes. Okay. And if I draw a chart around this, I go to insert and I go to column chart. Don't worry, we'll fix the column charts. Come here. Tell it that it's not supposed to plot the sizes. The sizes are the things it's supposed to show me. So I'm going to tell it that, Mr., do not plot the sizes. Remove this one. And then these labels are the sizes. Okay, good. Select it myself. These are the good. Good. So with this, I get the sizes, okay? I can make it look better. Format data series. I'm going to say that I need it to reduce the gap. Okay. Then I will say I want it to have a white outline so that to look nice. That's all. So this is the way it's saying I should buy it. I should buy more of a size 38, 39, 40. Or I should not buy too much of these. And so that's how I can start at least better than somebody who is not being analytical at all. Then later, as my historical data, sales data comes in, I will now have more information, more specific information to my store to now use to know how to restock, you know. So that's it. You can use the same knowledge for the gowns one. Okay, let's quickly do the gowns one. Now. Is Ctrl V, remove duplicates, count if in this range for this shoe size. Tell me how many of them I need to, or in this case, cloth size. And I think we need to even arrange this. So I need to sort this so that it comes in alphabetical order, smallest. Continue with my current selection. Okay, good. So now if I draw a chart on this, start, again, I'm going to tell it. Let me make this one select. Let me make this remove edits. The series that is supposed to plot this. Okay. And then the labels are the sizes. That's it. Okay. Then what was it we did the other time? We said it should reduce the gap. Okay. It should make its outline white. Just one, all of them. Line. Well, so you see, saying this is the way you should buy the dresses, the gowns. So thank you very, very much. This is the end of my session. So any question while I round off? Let's just put the numbers on top so that you know how many you are supposed to buy. Any questions? So in the absence of any questions, then I'm going to round up the session. I've already given us a practice file. For those who joined late, let me just paste it so that you will have it also. So I've repasted the practice file, and that's the end of today's session. Next week, we'll continue. Just to let you know, our sponsors or people we have partnered with is FMI Institute. You can do 40% discount code for exam. Let me get you the code in case you're interested in doing the exam. And let me even give you better news. So we moved to a new office space. For those of all you new who already know our office, we are still in Antony, but we moved somewhere else. One of the things that we are now trying to make possible is to allow people come to mock exams. So mock financial modeling exams. I don't know, maybe we'll look for a way to also allow people to mock Power BI exams. So those who want to do certifications will be able to at least intention for now is to make it free. So, not if we'll charge money later, but right now the plan is it to be free. So I'm telling you first, so that if later we charge money, at least you will have been part of the free sets. So in case you are thinking of doing this financial modeling exam and you've not really made up your mind, you can take advantage of the mock exam. I'm going to announce it when we are done with the whole logistics and the dates for the mock exam. Okay, so that one done. Then if you are interested in our training, we have financial modeling training coming up on 1st of November to 4th of November. And it would be nice to have you join us if you're interested. Any questions? So that's the end. Okay, I'm supposed to also
thank
let
you, Michael.
Yes, sir. Thank you for participating.
Yeah,
please
Michael,
give us.
Just so you don't forget, I'm actually very much interested in taking the AFM for the next exam, which is scheduled for February. So I'm still keeping tab, looking for that.
Okay.
Okay,
great. You should take advantage of the mock exam that we even want to do. So that way, you know, we time you. We have an alarm, a nice alarm. If that alarm rings, your brain will freeze. So it will help you to get used to it. So 4 hours, you know, give you a live question. Hopefully, maybe there will be 4 or 5 people. We can't do more than 6 people at once anyway. And then, you know, we monitor you as if it's an exam scenario. So it helps you to even have a feel of what it is like, you know, writing the exam. And we try and use a question that you probably do not know already, so that it looks like something completely new. So thank you to everyone. You can also check the chat box for the feedback. Let us know what your feedbacks are. If you have somebody you would like us to invite, you have a topic you would like us to cover. Yes, because these days we are running out of speakers and topics. So we appreciate any suggestions you give. And that brings us to the end of today's session. So have a very nice Sunday. And if you're interested in Excel, we have the Excel session coming up in about 1 hour's time. Let me just show you the details of that one. The guest we have is from Australia, but it's not going to be able to join us live. So what he's doing is that he has found a way, well, remote, like recorded the session for us, then he would take our questions and answer. But what he's covering is something interesting that if you use Excel, I will advise that you be a part of. So I'm going to give us the link. It's going to be Excel session by 4 p.m. Then we have Power BI. We have someone from, I think, India. And he's, for me, this is the most important tool concept in Power BI. This is the bedrock of Power BI. When people struggle with, even me, sometimes I still struggle with this thing. So, you know, if you're someone who uses Power BI, I will say don't miss this particular topic. So it's going to be by 6 p.m. When I saw the title, I was very happy. Like, yeah, I'm going to also refresh my knowledge. Because this is a very tough concept in Power BI and everything sits on it. So thank you very, very much and bye-bye.